Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Vedant Shenoy, and I'm here representing my team who have developed AstroNetra. AstroNetra brings visualization of astronomical catalogs right to your browser. It is currently hosted at astronetra.github.io. You can go there and you can check it out. You can play around with the interface and see how it works. What we do is we visualize all sky maps of astronomical catalogs. We provide object visibility from different AstroSat instruments. You can also browse properties of the individual objects, the papers that have been written about them using AstroSat data. And in general, AstroNetra will enable you to streamline your astronomy research. So going over a few key features of AstroNetra, the home page that we see here has an all sky map at the right, which allows you to see the distribution of objects across the entire sky. This here is in the galactic coordinates. You can see that most of the objects here are in the galactic plane. There are a few objects in the small and large Magellanic clouds. You can see the clusters here. You can change, toggle between galactic and array deck. In the left, we have this Aladdin light widget, which allows you to have a closer look. It allows you to click on each individual object and go to its own individual page as well as Simbad. You can change the background base map to any survey depending on your interests. For example, we've used PanSTARRS to note if there is any optical counterpart to the X-ray binary. Each object has its own individual page where you can see X-ray binary and optical counterpart properties from the catalog that we have been given. It also contains a few quick links to other missions and archives like SDSS and PanSTARRS and other data archives that exist on the internet right now. You can see a few relevant papers about the X-ray binaries. You can go to NASA ADS for looking them up. And it also provides all the AstroSat observations in which this object was in the field of view. We have not done a name-based search because in certain crowded fields like the Magellanic Clouds, you can definitely have one source within the field of view even if the proposal was for another source. So we have done a radius-based query for each source in the catalog to figure out whether they are visible with that particular observation or not. Moving on to how you can use AstroNetra for your astronomical research, we have provided two case studies. The first is studying cyclotron resonance scattering feature, or the CRSF, in a high mass X-ray binary 4U1538-522. And the second one, we look up how AstroNetra can help streamline research, taking the example of the UOCS, the UWIT Open Cluster Study. So to begin with, the CRSF in the high mass X-ray binary. The user experience that we wanted to emulate here was of a researcher deciding which physical phenomena to study. In this case, we decided that we wanted to study the cyclotron feature because that directly gives us a measure of the magnetic field of the compact object. Then the researcher has to use their experience to select what kind of target, what class of object do you want to study. We decided we'll look up high mass X-ray binaries. And by playing around on the homepage for a little bit, we came up and decided finally that we would select this target 4U1538-522. We did this by looking at the papers which studied this object. We found that there was a recent LAXPC paper which found CRSF at about 22 keV in this object. After that, we basically queried ADS. We looked up observations by other satellites and missions, and we found that there was a very recent another paper by a NuSTAR team, which also detected the CRSF in an old piece of data, and they showed that the cyclotron feature had shifted by about 1 keV from the early 2000s when it was observed by Suzaku, Integral, and Rosat. So what we decided to do was we decided to take the latest data that was available to us from the NuSTAR catalog, and that is what we have shown here. This is the NuSTAR spectra. We have fitted a continuum model. We use the absorbed high-cut model with a fixed galactic absorption factor. And what we see is that there are the residuals with quite a large chi-square, and showing features are about 6.5 and 22 keV. This 6.5 keV feature we presumed was the Ion K alpha line, and that this 22 keV feature was what we were after, the CRSF. So to account for this, we added a few components to the model. All the analysis was done using XSPEC. By adding a Gaussian and an absorbed Gaussian component, we get a much better fit, a chi-square of 901 for 876 degrees of freedom. And we observe that the ion line is at 6.35 keV, and the CRSF is indeed at 21.9 keV. The results are consistent within the error bars to the two studies that were done, Varun et al. 2019 on the LAXPC data and Hemphill et al. 2019 on the older NewSTAR data. This is the first time that the sort of study was done with that set of NewSTAR data. We have added basically another data point to the time evolution of the CRSF. The second case study that we wanted to point out was to show how AstroNetra can be used to study different kinds of objects. So, for example, now we have provided X-ray binaries. In the future, someone may want to study different kinds of objects. Here we have provided open clusters. One of the open cluster studies that is being conducted right now with UVIT is UOCS, which aims to study post-mass transfer binaries in open clusters. Jadhav et al. 2021, which was published just a few months ago, provided an ML-based membership probability using astrometry and photometry from Gaia EDR3. The photometry of these post-mass transfer binaries is quite non-standard. It does not fit in with the rest of the color. They occupy certain non-standard positions on the color magnitude diagram. For example, blue straggler stars occupy the region beyond the main sequence cutoff. So by comparing membership probabilities that you would get from astrometry only with astrometry plus photometry, you would see that these non-standard stars form a decline in membership probability when you account for photometry. This was a brief overview of the paper. What we will now demonstrate is how our interface can be used to streamline a study like this. So the front page of AstroNetra, for example, would show similar all-sky plots for open clusters. The individual pages that we showed earlier it had properties for X-ray binaries. It did not have interactive plots, but that is not a constraint. We can add these interactive plots. What we have done is we have shown two example figures that we have adapted from figures from the paper. Users can view properties of individual stars. They can find the Gaia source IDs of peculiar stars that were studied in that paper. And they can also find stars which have UV photometry. Generating these plots is trivial, part of the web tool itself. In addition to helping the researchers, these visualizations are very useful for teaching and outreach purposes as well. So just as an example, I will show you what we have put up as interactive plots. So here we can see the color magnitude diagram of Messier 67. The colorful points that you see here are all UVIT data points. So they are all stars which have been observed by UVIT. You can see that some of the blue straggler stars, for example, have data for them. We can add components to this so that you can query the Gaia data from here itself or get the UVIT photometry from this hover bar. In addition, we have also provided this hover functionality for different types of interactive plots. This allows you to sort of play around with the data and see which stars have lower probability in some data sets. So if you include systematics, which in Gaia EDR3 means if you have something like an X-ray binary or a very closed unresolved binary, which has wobbles in the proper motion, the fit for the proper motion will not be the same as for an individual star. So that will show higher systematics. So this is basically a measure of how a star varies from normality. So you can see that all these blue straggler stars, all the binaries on this main sequence all come up in that category. And we also have this quantitative measure of peculiarity or distance from the color magnitude diagram that was made by the authors, and we have demonstrated that here as well. So in conclusion, for our future work, what we plan to do is to include larger catalogs in the backend. Currently for X-ray binaries, we were using a data set which is almost two decades old. We want to incorporate newer data sets. We want to add the 5+ years of AstroSat observations that have been done. The papers, we want to actually integrate it completely with ATS so that it's not just the AstroSat papers that are shown. We can also show papers from other missions and satellites which study this object. We also want to try to integrate the virtual observatory in the individual pages, which would allow for directly downloading data products from our interface itself, as well as editor interfaces to customize the properties that are shown and modify this for usage with other Indian telescopes and observatories. In conclusion, we've demonstrated AstroNetra and its key functions. We provided all-sky visualizations, we list out properties and papers. We provide two case studies of how AstroNetra can be used to streamline and facilitate research in astronomy, and we note that this interface can not only help researchers but also outreach purpose for AstroSat and its instruments. Thank you. I can take questions.
Thank you for the wonderful presentation. Looks like you are more into astronomy research than I don't know whether engineering. Okay, so just one simple question. In the last two slides, you showed what are your plans for your future plans for this particular project. So that does that mean that you want to take it further than this Correct. Whatever you have presented is in this intermeet, or do you what kind of plans do you have? Like, will you be releasing it openly?
Currently it is openly released. It is hosted on a web page that I had shown earlier. And yes, we do plan to continue working on this interface and improving it and adding more functionality. And in fact, extending it to other Indian observatories and telescopes like GMRT, for example, that would be definitely something that we would like to follow up on. Yes.
So will you be open for collaboration with these observatories and, say, for example, AstroSat community?
Correct. We would be, definitely.
Okay. So just one another question before the other judges take over. So though you have done a lot of analysis and you have come up with the new results and even exciting results and matching whatever the results published, etc., mm-hmm. I do not know, I did not see a real correlation between whatever the analysis you have done with whatever the project it is, that is visualization. So direct right. correlation, did I miss that slide or?
So the visualization aspect of it, what we decided was that we wanted to show how the user could select a target, for example, for their studies. And that's why we chose X-ray binaries as the first topic to use. So is it fine if I show you a sort of demo of the interface? I have it open.
If the organizers are okay with it.
All right.
Yeah, that's fine. Just keep it limited to 30 seconds. 30 seconds to a minute, maybe.
All right. So here, for example, I've opened up GRS 1915 plus, it's a low mass X-ray binary. So what we wanted them to do was to use this for their research. So putting up all these papers that have done similar sort of research in the past, the author or the users can get a feel for what kind of studies have been done with LMXBs or in particular this target. In addition, the visualization aspect here, since we are using Aladdin light, which a lot of astronomers would be familiar with, it allows them, you know, some form of familiarity to go around and change the sky map and so on. So the visualization aspect we wanted to do was to facilitate research and not only for visualization for itself.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for the nice talk and the hard work that you have put in. And certainly you have been more concerned on how this can be useful to the astronomy community. So in that sense, your talk is and the work is really useful, I felt.
Thank you.
Professor Antia, do you have any comments, suggestions?
Okay, I forgot what team ID this is.
We are nine.
Are there any more questions, judges?
No, just one suggestion. I would suggest that. I mean, whatever that iron line and the CRSF that you have shown actually, and you have shown this plus minus number, that plus minus things may not be accurate what you have shown. So you may have to be a little concerned about this. Like, iron line we don't usually observe with a plus minus of 0.1 kV or something. It's usually more broader than that.
I see. Okay. No, so this is just the centroid frequency. We have not, if you want, I can show you the...
So that's okay, no problem. So, as you study more, actually...
So the sigma is... Okay. Yeah, the sigma is larger. It's about 0.1. I mean, yeah. This is just the error in the...
Okay.
The centroid frequency.
What data is this?
So here for this we use New Star data.
What he's saying is, so correct. You have put an error of 0.03 keV, that is right. 30 eV.
So yes.
New Star do not have that kind of resolution at that.
I see. Okay. I think we will have to have a closer look at our analysis then. Yes. Thank you for that.
And you yourself have fit the data?
Yes, we have fit the data. Kunal, who had trouble joining, was in charge of that. So he used XSpec.
Okay.
To fit the models. Yes.
Fine. Okay.
Thank you. It's a nice presentation, and you have done a lot of analysis, which
thank
we
you.
Were not expecting actually.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.